Hello everyone, welcome to this lecture. Today we're going to be deriving the Schrödinger equation. So to do that, first we must ask ourselves why it is that we are interested in the existence of an equation such as the Schrödinger equation. So in classical mechanics, whenever we wanted to have basically all the information that there is to know about a system, we would like to find all the forces, and with it we can then find the acceleration, which with then together with some of the equations from kinematics, we can then use to basically know everything there is to know about a system. So in quantum mechanics, there is not really such a thing as forces. It's because we're just talking about individual particles, and it is much more intuitive to have a different approach. So we're going to be using something that I hope you may have seen in some of your theoretical classical mechanics courses, which is the Hamiltonian formulation, which basically works by knowing what is the Hamiltonian of the system. So in order to find this Schrödinger equation, we are going to want the Hamiltonian of the system acting on the system, because, well, this is an operator, we're going to be working with operators. This psi right here, this is just a Greek letter psi, this is going to be our particle, because remember, in quantum mechanics, particles have this wave duality, so they will be described by a wave equation. That's what we usually call psi. Now, whenever the Hamiltonian acts on psi, it's going to give us the energy of our system. This is actually the most basic form of the Schrödinger equation. This is the Schrödinger equation. But the problem is, this is a very compact form. We can't really do too much with it, at least for now. So what we want is to find a more explicit way to write this equation. So let's take a look at what is its Hamiltonian. The Hamiltonian, let's think of a free particle that may be close to some potential. So the Hamiltonian of a particle that can move will have a kinetic energy term, and it will also have a potential energy term. So the kinetic energy, we can write it from what we know from classical mechanics. At least for now, the Schrödinger equation will not consider relativistic effects, so we can just write it in its classical form. The mass times velocity squared divided by 2, and the potential will just be V. It can be many things, there are many different kinds of potentials, so it will be just in its general form. Now the problem with this form of the Hamiltonian is that we want the Hamiltonian to depend only on the generalized coordinates and the generalized momenta. So we don't really want it to depend on the velocity, which is q dot. So what we can do is either apply a Legendre transform, or we can just see that the momentum in classical mechanics for a non-relativistic particle, of course, is just the mass times the velocity. So the velocity is just this momentum, which now will be an operator, divided by the mass of the particle. So if we write this in here, we're going to get that the mass divided by 2 is just the momentum operator squared divided by the mass squared, and plus this potential. Now with this, we can just cancel out one of the masses, and we're going to get that the Hamiltonian is going to be the momentum operator squared divided by 2m plus the potential. This is going to be our Hamiltonian operator. So now if you write it into this primitive form of the Schrödinger equation, we're going to get that the momentum operator squared divided by 2m plus the potential, and all of this acting on our system, is going to be the energy operator acting on our system. Now this is much better, and we can do more with this, but we still have the problem that we don't really know what this momentum operator or this energy operator are. And in order to be able to actually do something with this equation, we need to find an explicit form for those two operators. So in order to do that, there is a more formal derivation, but it does require more knowledge of quantum mechanics. And since we're just starting, we're going to use something that maybe not be the most thorough derivation, but at least will give you an idea of where this comes from. So remember that a particle that has an associated de Broglie wavelength will have a wave equation of the form e to the I kx minus omega t. Now, the energy for such a wave would be h bar times omega, and its momentum would be h bar times k, the wave number. So now we can from here see that omega, the frequency, will just be the energy, which will now be an operator, divided by h bar, and k will just be the momentum divided by h bar. So when we replace this in here, we get that e to the I, and now it's no longer kx, now it's going to be px divided by h bar minus et divided by h bar. I'm just going to restore the operator notation at the end, and we can just factor out the h bar, and we get this, which is also a very well known form of a wave equation. So now what we want to do is we want to find a form for p and e. So we need to get them out of this exponential. So in order to do that, we can just take the derivative with respect to the position and with respect to time. So let's start with the derivative with respect to position, which will give us, let's see, it's just I divided by h bar. Remember, h bar is just h divided by 2 pi, and h is Planck's number. It is 6.634 something to 10 minus 34, I think. You can just look it up on the internet. It's a well-known universal constant. So, and we also get a p down here, and the rest stays the same. Px h bar minus et. So, but this term right here is just our wave, so we can instead write psi. So now we know when we take the derivative, we just get I pi over h times this same psi. So we can now drop the wave sign and just take a look at the operators. So the derivative operator with respect to x is going to give us I times the momentum operator with respect to h. divided by h bar. And so we can from here find that the momentum operator is just going to be h bar over I times the derivative with respect to x. And this is our first important result. This is our momentum operator. Now we can do exactly the same, but taking the derivative with respect to time. And we're going to get minus I e over h bar times our wave function, just like the last time. So from here, we can once again just drop the wave functions and just take a look at our operator. So the derivative with respect to time is going to be equal to minus I times this energy operator divided by h bar. So the energy operator is going to be minus h bar over I dt, and we can now rewrite this as I h bar dt. Here, what we did is we just multiplied and divided by I, so we got an I up there, and in the denominator we had minus 1, which cancelled out this minus sign right here. So these are the two operators that we were looking for, and we can now replace them to find the final form of the Schrödinger equation. So what we had before was that the momentum operator squared divided by 2m plus potential acting on our wave function. This is just the energy operator acting on the wave function. So now we can write for this what we just found, which is for momentum, it's h bar over I d dx squared, and this is multiplied by 1 over 2m, plus the potential, and all of this is acting on psi, and the energy operator, as we just saw, is I h bar d dt, And now we can just take this square term, and we're going to get h bar over 2 with a negative sign because this I squared is minus 1, divided by 2m d squared dx of psi plus v psi. This is equal to I h bar d dt times psi. And this is the well-known form of the Schrödinger equation that we will be using later on to find many very important results. So this is the Schrödinger equation. Now, we will be talking about the significance and interpretation of this equation in the next video. Right now, I just want to leave it here. This is how we derive this equation. We will then talk about the interpretation in the next video, and hopefully in the ones after that, we can already start talking about applying this equation and finding some useful results. So I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, leave me a comment. If you have any questions, leave it as well. I'll make sure to reply to them. So thank you very much. See you next time.